All right, everybody, it's a couple days later because all kinds of things happen and need to be taken care of, but we've heard from the people with training and experience, and yes, the compressor module does lift right out of a spline in the gearbox. So we're going to remove that, but before we do that, we're going to finish installing the compressor, the axial compressor cases onto the diffuser scroll, or the centrifugal stage. I was going to call it the diffuser scroll, but that's this part, the part we're going to paint. So it's very difficult to reach underneath there, and this big clunky thing is in the way of a couple of these bolts. So we're going to zoom in here and I'll show you something that turned out very well for me. Hang on. Okay, way in there. Let's see. Let's get a bit better. Right there. Way in there. It's very difficult to get a wrench in there because it's underneath. So what you need to do is either customize a wrench, or maybe there's a special tool. But over here, you need a very, very short wrench. You could use a torque adapter, I suppose. That would work. I just don't have one for 7/32. But what I did build back in the day, we had a very difficult, these are difficult bolts or nuts to reach. We had a nearly impossible one. We had a nearly impossible one to reach in the LM500. I don't know if you remember the LM500 build, but that was 5 or 6, maybe more. That was a long time ago. Anyway, we had to reach down a hole and undo from the back and do up, of course, a 7/32 nut. So we made this monstrosity. Is it in the frame there? It's got a, I don't know why it has a square drive male. It should have had a female up here, but that was our mistake at the time. I think we turned it with a crescent wrench, a strut across, and then all the way down. And then we bent the end of a steel rod and we put the end of a 7/32 box wrench in there. Let's see. Oh, there we go. There we go. We're getting that. So this turned out to be the magic tool. It doesn't need to be so long, but let me just get you in there. All right. So we've got our bolt. Little bit of anti-seize on there. It just falls into place. And now, see, I can't, my hands are too fat. My hands are too big to get in there and start the nut. So let's try it with a conventional wrench. And again, this location here is easier than those three that are this big ugly things in the way. So can I do that? Can I start this by hand? Oh, okay. I can. Well, that's really not that bad. So now I could certainly, in this position, because this high thing is not really in the way, I've got a sweep of about from there to there. So I could do it up with this wrench. But in the other situations, I can't get in there. So this is what I did. I put this thing there to hold it. Actually, I used the, see, if you've got a ball end, you can't put a lot of torque through that or it'll just strip, it'll chew up the bolt. Anyway, I'll put the whole square end in there and hold this. And so I've got to go this way. Okay, there we go. So this is magic. It's short enough that it fits into this space here, this valley between that part and this part. I'm going to make sure I'm doing it the right way, this way. Okay. I've just got my hand on the top of this thing. If it was shorter, I wouldn't have so much wonkiness trying to match up the nut. Okay. There we go. And when we get to the end, we're working through the self-locking section of the nut on the thread, so it does take a bit of work. A little bit of work. But this really sped up the process, especially the starting, because I, on the other ones deep inside here, I couldn't get my fat hand down in there to do it up. So we're almost at the point where we're reaching contact. Okay, there we go. Now I'm going to pull out a bit. Okay, so our magic little torque wrench goes, it works, it's like an over center thing. It goes either way. It'll supply torque either way. And like I said, I put this square drive on there. I don't know why I did that. Can't remember all those years ago. But it does fit a 9/32 12 point very nicely. And I've got a U-joint on there so that I've got a bit of leeway with what I'm going to do there. So we want to go this way, and I can actually torque that bolt like that, just like magic. So this tool really has been sitting in my toolbox for years, and we found a second use for it. Just fantastic. So now this is all done up. I've torqued up all the other nuts on both vertical flanges. These are vertical in the operating position of the engine. These are horizontal flanges. They are all torqued and happy, and they look great now because all the bolts have been hand cleaned. So what we're going to do now is regroup. We're going to regroup, have a meeting with ourselves, and we're going to try to get this compressor section off. And when I say try, the only difficult part is going to be this difficult bolt we looked at last time. I'm going to grind an inexpensive wrench down to paper thinness. We're going to try to get that out. That really could be a bolt from the other direction, but it isn't. That's the way it is. It's difficult. That's the one we're going to tackle first. It's going to be a while. When I do that, we'll have the cameras on there. But right now, I have to create some tooling and figure out what I'm going to do. Also, this thing is shimmed in place to within a thousandth of an inch. So each bolt has a specific shim on there, or set of shims that we need to record and clean and set aside and not mess up when we put it back together, which may be in a couple of weeks. So that's why probably each shim set will be labeled in a bag and set aside together. And we'll also photograph each nut bolt combination as it gets removed, because we must not get that wrong. All right, so it's a couple hours later because I had lunch and I did other things. I had to go to the other shop, and I also did the things they never tell you to do in the book, any book. So what did we do? First of all, we make sure that we've labeled each of the bolts with a name, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I've made up a box with 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, because 5 is going in a separate bag. And we've cleaned up the shop a little bit. So when I pick this piece off, I don't stand around and think, where am I going to put it? I have a clean area that it's going to set down on. And then we're going to immediately cover the exposed open gearbox with a piece of plastic that's been cleaned. We might tape it down. Because if we're going to paint this thing, first of all, we have to remove the scroll from the compressor. That's going to be a bit of work, this and that, whatever, some fasteners. It's going to be a day or two before we put things back together. So we have to make sure that no dirt gets in there and that we don't forget where the pieces go. Okay, so once that's all done, took about 20 minutes of cleaning and sorting and organizing and getting ready, because the exciting part is taking it off, but you need to be ready to put it somewhere. You need to be ready to accept the article. Okay. They don't really tell you that in the book. They just say a clean and organized shop is essential for the procedures to proceed successfully, or something like that. Cleanliness is important. They always say that. So, first thing we're going to do is we made our tool. I'm going to show you that, and then we're going to use it. We'll actually take off. I called it number one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are the fasteners we're taking off. And so I took a picture of this with all the little labels on there, so that if they get lost and mixed up, it's like, well, which one's number one? Which one's number one? Uh-oh, well, we got a picture of it. No problem. So, okay, so the way we numbered these by convention is actually slightly different from convention. This is the front of the engine. This is the back down here. So looking forward, from the rear, or aft looking forward. Aft looking forward, number one would be the first one clockwise of the upper, the top. So that would have been the one I called number three, because I started here on the most difficult one, the famous one. I called that one number one, two, three, four, five. And so we're gonna do that. We made a wrench, we took a non-expensive wrench. And I got that in the, there we go. And we ground it down so it's, it fits, it's almost paper thin. I could have taken these side heels off a bit more because it gives us basically one, what'd you call it, flat, one point of a 12-point bolt, 12-point nut or bolt, one point of movement. Anyway, and luckily this was not an over-tightened bolt, so it came out nicely, and we've got it to the point now where it's basically finger tight, but I could only go that far. So about, what, is that 45 degrees? That's how much movement I could get. What's 12 into 360? It's 30, so 30 degrees. All right, I can't quite get this all with just finger, but it's looking good. Maybe if I loosen this, this bolt goes down through a bracket and this bolt goes up through the same bracket. Maybe if I loosen off the other side, that will help us. Okay, so that is two. Two. And the shims will be between the gearbox casing and the scroll, so we haven't got there yet. This thing now can turn more easily. Yes, this is an interesting little doohickey. Hope you guys are appreciating the lack of space music. I got some complaints. Sorry about that. There will be space music in the future because it's not really, what's the word? Copyrighted, I suppose. It's just all sort of synthesized on the fly. Copyright for music in the background of videos is a real bummer. Okay, so we've got that, got the bolt, that's number one. Put the bracket, actually I'm gonna take a picture of this. I'm gonna take a picture of that, even though I have the video now showing what the heck it looks like. But I'm gonna take a picture. So, I'm gonna set it down. Just like that. So before we started the undoing and removal of the bolts, I went to each one, each of the five, and I detorqued them. So I turned them about a quarter to a half of a turn just to make sure that none of them are tight. And actually one, two, three, four were what you'd expect. And number five was unbelievably, ridiculously, ridiculously tight. So that may have been from corrosion. Or it could have been put together that way all those years and decades before. There's only a certain amount of torque that a quarter inch stud can handle. And I think that was pretty close to the limit. So there's a table in the overhaul manual about torques of these nuts on these bolts and on quarter inch studs on this engine. They say 70 to 100 inch pounds. This thing was over 200 by my calibrated guesser here. By my kinesthetic sensors. There's over 200 inch pounds on there. Anyway, we're continuing. So this one, we've got lots of access. We're lucky we can just use a good old 5/16 socket. I like it when it's easy. It's always easier when it's easy. It doesn't look like there's any shims underneath there, but we'll have to carefully inspect everything. As a truck box fabrication is happening next door, a custom aluminum pickup truck box, all handmade. So there's the odd bit of smashing and bashing, I suppose. I don't know why that's skipping. This is an unworn 5/16, and that's a 5/16, but it seems to be, it's a little loose. I tried a 9/32 on there and it didn't go. So it's gotta be a 5/16. And there's no real damage to the nut. So we'll just be careful. That's what we try to do here, is always be careful. A, B, C. Okay. Okay, so we got our 5/16, which slipped, and that should never happen. So that's obviously the wrong size. We've got a 1/4 12-point, and that's a no-go. So the only thing between there is a 9/32 when you're talking fractional English. And don't get on my case about metric making more sense, because I agree with you. Oh, we're in trouble now. Let's see. 9/32, and this is 10/32, and it slips. So don't tell me there's a freaking, what, 1/964, not, that's ridiculous. Actually, this looks like a very worn 5/16, so we're going to check that when we get it off. I'm going to try very nicely with the 5/16 if it can move. Oh, it does move, if I'm very gentle and careful. But I think it's very worn, because it should never slip like that. The socket is one of those brand name guys. Oh, look at that. It skipped. The socket is one of those brand name guys from the trucks, and it's brand new. So it's not worn. What's the deal? What's the dealio? Coming off now, but you see it should never skip like that. I think the nut is just extreme. Yeah, it is. It's very rounded off. It's like somebody used a power driver and let it go zing and then just left it there, because what the hell? Somebody else will have to worry about that in 30 years. Yeah, buddy, that's me. And the nut is very strong in its self-locking feature, so it's iffy getting this off. Oh. We do not want to use any Neanderthal means of getting this off, like pliers or anything like that. It's, come on, oh, it's, this is terrible. Oh, every time the wrench skips, you lose a point in the game of life. I'm gonna spray clean the exposed part of the stud and then put some lube on there and see if that does anything. I'm highly doubtful if it will, but this is not good. Not good. Again, this is all exciting live footage from the shop at Jet City Turbines. The glamour and the glitz of working on turbine engines. Now we're going to use our sponsor. Our sponsor's oil, the good old alphanumeric professional oil. See? It says specialist. You know, those guys with the blue and the yellow. They sent me the hoodie and the shirt. Okay. I'm also gonna check if maybe a wrench fits better. 5/16. Oh, but you see, here's the problem. You can't turn it very far. That's a better, more secure grip. The spline drive is great. It's my favorite. Okay, it's got a long way to go, but it's coming. Yeah. So basically, the spline drive has a better grip on really worn fasteners, and it'll work on 12-point, 8-point, 6-point, and 4-point bolts. It's fantastic. I know some technicians don't like spline drive, but I do like it. The unfortunate thing about spline drive fasteners is they can only be undone by spline drive wrenches. And so the wrenches are great, the fasteners, I wouldn't say that. Okay, it's loosening up now. So, well, let's just get it to the top before I try the socket again. This is the last one, this is number 5. So as it turns out, number 5 was the hardest one, not number 1. Because of this worn nature. Oh man. Now, let's cover something. Let's cover something. Now this happens all the time. So I know that some of you are saying, it's the wrong size socket, you moron. That looks like it's the wrong size socket. It's slipping, it doesn't look like you're doing it right. It may not look like I'm doing it right on a 3-inch video screen or your 17-inch or your 36-inch monitor. This is a brand new expensive socket, unworn, 12 point. And it does say, look at that, it says 5/16 on there, which usually indicates it's a 5/16. Not 5-16, but 5/16. 5/16. This is a 5/16 bolt head. So you may be there, and it may look like I'm doing it wrong, but I'm here and I'm doing it. So thank you very much. All right, that was fun. That little public service announcement was fun. So now the socket does not work. It's just slipping, but the wrench does. But you can see that this fitting's in the way. I could have taken that fitting out. I'll probably do that in the future. I don't know why I didn't do it before, but I didn't. So maybe because we're thinking about working on the top parts first and then the lower parts later. I don't know. But this will take it off just fine. And we're going to find a replacement. We have quite a stock of these 12-point aviation nuts. And this one is very worn. As a matter of fact, it was so tight. Yeah, maybe that's it. Maybe the reason it was so tight is somebody had a power tool and they just hit her and then it started to spin and then they said, oh, it must be on, and just pulled this power drive socket off and left it. So you never know the history of who's been working on the engines, especially when they're in the aftermarket like this thing. This is a long since retired aviation engine. It has had who knows any number of non-professionals working on it, each with their own habits and preferences. Okay, yeah, it's been spun quite severely on half of it anyway. So that goes into the bag for 5. And we're gonna pick off the washer. Is everybody asleep yet? I'm still working. Let's see. Yeah, so that, oh, the washer just barely comes off because it contacts the case. We may have to actually leave it there. Yeah, oh, no, okay. All right, so we're gonna lift this off. Now, yes, the crudely made agricultural output shaft is in the way. So, okay, pay no attention to the messy shelves behind, but right there, you can see that the housing, the scroll, won't go by this thing. And this is a big, ugly steel. This is the output shaft where a U-joint bolts onto. This is not part of the engine for a helicopter, so I can't lift it past that. I don't think I can, because, it's a matter of millimeters, really, because it has to come up a little bit more so it can slide over. So I'm gonna rest it back down. Being very disappointed. Let's see. But for now, I've got to try to get this out. And it's on there with a great big old huge ugly nut. So hang on. Okay, we fabricated a tool yesterday to, well, let's just show you. Bing bang. Okay, we took out the drive plate, super heavy thing, because there's a big nut back here. We had to go get the nut, and we couldn't use a long breaker bar because there was so much torque at such different places. We created, I guess, what they call a rocking couple in a two-piston engine, but anyway, the whole thing wanted to spit off, and I couldn't hang on to it. So what I did was, I made a torque holder, bolted that on like that, and then put the massive 1600 foot-pound torque wrench or air ratchet underneath there, put my shoulder against the anti-torque thing and hit it, hoping that I wouldn't get thrown on the floor. And actually the nut spun off with next to nothing. It was just a little bit stuck. So that's out of there now. It's not in the way. And it's time to remove the compressor module. Once we are cleared of everything, should just lift right out. So let's try that. Here we go. Oh, yep. Oh, yeah. Okay, now this is gonna go. I know I'm out of the frame here, but I'll show you. Okay, so that spur adapter gear shaft. All right, so what we're gonna do is use some very high-tech spacer blocks made of scrap wood to keep this thing level. There we go. And this is extremely temporary. I'm just gonna clean up this area and we'll take a look at that and we'll look down into the gearbox first. Let's do that. Okay, that's where the compressor was sitting. And the stickiness we encountered on removal was this outer or inner diameter against the outer diameter of a bearing housing. Okay, so we can look right down in there. That's the compressor turbine shaft. We're basically gonna do this, cover it. So we can't really see what's in there by looking through. And we're gonna make sure nothing falls in there until we are finished with removing this thing, giving it a quick surface prep, and then painting it, and replacing it, and reinstalling everything. All right, so what I've done is made the executive decision to turn this thing on its side, which is how we're gonna work on it. So, you can see that it's kind of like the nether regions. There's a lot of dirt and crap in there because it is a space that really isn't accessible, but it's not sealed. And this is the spline through which the power of the turbine turns the compressor. And this is the gear that interfaces with that one we were just looking at. That's the first stage of reduction. It takes 50,900 RPM. I'm correcting myself because I used to be saying 51,900, but this engine turns at 50,900 for the, we'll call it the HP system, but it's really the compressor turbine. So the compressor scroll lifts off and it's held on by these screws, bolt screws. So we're going to unlock wire those, undo them and pull the compressor scroll off. There's a big O-ring that we're gonna replace. And there's actually an O-ring here. Right here, this is the O-ring that was sealing the diameter into which this outside diameter slipped. And there's a bit of crud up there we're gonna clean off. We're gonna make sure this all stays scrupulously clean. And when we reinstall it, it might be a little bit easier to go back in. So when we do reinstall, we're gonna need to rotate the compressor rotor or through the tack generator drive the entire compressor turbine gear assembly to make sure this spline matches up with the tube it's going into. Other than that, it is a module. So we completed this operation. We completed this operation with the generous help of the people that are trained and work professionally on this engine. I learned a little bit about it in school, but I'm not an experienced 250 mechanic, so this scary step was made possible by the generosity of the people out there that actually do work on these engines, and I really appreciate that. So we are gonna use that resource when we can, if we need to, but right now I'm gonna remove the mounting plate, or actually remove the diffuser scroll from the mounting plate. Okay, so we've got the thing standing on its nose, and we're taking out these screws that hold the mounting plate to the compressor scroll. I'm gonna come in here and take a close look because there was a comment yesterday by somebody saying, you know, it's just a redneck after hours project, why don't you just leave it? It doesn't matter. For the amount of time you're gonna use it, eh. And there's some logic to that, which we'll get to. But I disagree because at first I would have disagreed because it's a very simple thing to remove and get off and paint and bing bang, put it back together. Yeah, it's turned out not to be that way. So there's a second reason why we need to take it apart, because this is the last chance. It's either gonna stay this way until it blows up, or we can just barely get it apart and rehab the fasteners and the things that the fasteners are fastening together. So let me show you what I mean. Hang on. Okay, so these little things are screw head things. Here's one that's been removed. And half of them were quite cheerful. They just came out with probably about 50 inch pounds, which seems like a lot. But you can see the head there, right by the lock wire holes? That's corrosion. And this is a very strong little bolt, because that with 50 inch pounds is, or 50 or 60 is punching way above its weight. Anyway, that's typical for an aircraft fastener. But there's one that after a great deal of massaging and careful coaxing and squeezing and hammering and penetrating oiling and everything, it broke. So that ain't good, but we can remove the casing and then we can get at it and we can do a stud extraction. We can get that out and replace it. So we're gonna have to probably order these. These are probably like 20 bucks each or more. Anyway, we'll figure something out. Several of these, most of them are loosened, but I've tightened them back up to take the stress off the separating forces for the two. I think there's two left that are still stuck. Okay, so how do you coax these out? Well, you're gonna go through the process with me. There's two more that, I think there's one that's completely seized in there and one that I got to squeak once by really getting the feeling of over massively, massive blastingly over torquing the thing. So first thing is you want the screwdriver not to slip, okay? I've had one skip on this and I'm quite embarrassed about that, but it's a slotted head screw, and I hate those. The only thing worse than a standard screw is a nail. We don't find nails in turbine engines unless things have really gone wrong. Okay, so we're not gonna use our feeble wrist power. We're gonna use a square shank screwdriver and a wrench on there. The expensive ones, you probably knew this, but that thing there, the bolster, that's for a wrench. So we use the right arm, thumb basically, to push down and not dislodge the work from the work stand. And we use the wrench to apply the torque, and let's see what we can do. Come on. That's the one that's totally seized. We'll come back to that one. I think this is the one that I made it squeak once, and oh, that's too easy. Okay, where is it? Is it here? There's two bolts left that I need to get out. Yeah, this is it. Oh, that's easy as well. Okay. I have to find, maybe there is only one left. That one. Yeah, that's it. Okay, so if it squeaks, we're happy. It might break, which would make me unhappy. But we've got one broken already. Way too much. Oh, it's turning. Oh, it's way over torqued. The problem is, you can see how long it is. The resistance is down here, the torque's up there. So the whole thing twists. So that's why an impact driver would be useless, and so would an air impact tool to rattle it out, because it's a torsion spring, basically. It's like a torsion bar. It's like an anti-roll bar in the front of your 67 Camaro. Or Chevelle. 66 Chevelle. Oh, this just feels like you're destroying things. But if the bolt breaks, we'll get it out. Okay, we're half a turn. That's good. Just a second. Okay, there we are, folks. And we're on there. So you tell me when you see it start to move up here, and I'll tell you, am I gonna be in the way? I'm gonna be in the way. Let me move the camera. Okay, what we're gonna do is, you can watch it. I hope you can see. I'm not in the way, am I? Okay, you can see it move, and I'll tell you when I start to feel it move in the threads. Oops, don't skip the screwdriver. Okay, here we go. Applying torque now. You can see the head moving. Oh, there, it's starting to move in the threads. It's way too much torque. That feels like 200 inch pounds or more on a tiny little There, it's loosening up, it's better now. Still really, really tough. It should just spin in there. It's, oh man. The running torque to get this thing to move right now is more than the final torque should be. Oh, yeah, we just broke it. Okay. So, okay, somebody pointed out that this engine is 50 years old in about a week, and it's probably been sitting in water or something, so we may find some heavy corrosion on the inside. I hope not, but we just broke two of those bolts, screws, whatever, machine screws. They're special too. So they're so narrow, they're so thin. I can't believe that much torque is on there. They may have been over-torqued when it was built, but I doubt it. I think they're just stuck in the threads in the diffuser scroll. So we'll have to do some really good cleaning of those threads when we get it all apart. We'll have to extract those two bolts somehow. It's going to be murder. Maybe weld a nut on there or something. The other ones, I'm just going to take them out. We're going to separate this. So I hate breaking fasteners, but there was nothing else I could do. You can't even get in there with a torch to make a difference. Plus, it's magnesium alloy. I'm not heating up a magnesium alloy case with a torch. Thank you very much. So it's about an hour later. We managed to squeeze this thing off. The problem, the stickiness, was this huge O-ring. Can you see that in there? There's a big old O-ring here, very crusty. Let's see if we can peel it out. I wonder if it's, well, the last overhaul was 1971, wasn't it? Anyway, it looks like a silicone O-ring, and it's flattened into a D shape, and it's very crusty. So we're gonna replace it. But when you've got a large O-ring in a smooth bore, with the crustiness of years and decades, it's often very difficult to get apart. But it's a good thing we did take this apart, because there's a gasket there. Let's take a look at that. There's a gasket right there separating the scroll from the compressor thing. And it had moved and broken. And I think it was, the gasket was, actually there's pieces missing of it. And it was starting to move into the, I guess out of the gas path. This is the exterior here that we were cleaning before. There was leakage and corrosion and just general crustiness. And if you look at this thing's been cleaned up. I've actually wiped it off and sprayed it with Brake Clean to get rid of some of the grime and gunk. So this is the piece we're gonna be painting. And those things, the inserts and the holes, you should be able to spin the bolt in by hand, no problem. There's no self-locking feature there. So this particular one there, that's one of the ones where the bolts were seized, but it didn't break. So I needed to rehab it. I made one of these. Let's see that. You see that? It's got the little, where is it now? There we go. You put a slice in there with a file. Can you see that? And so it's like a tap, but it's less aggressive. It chews its way through. I used this thing, this is my sample, and this thing, I used this and this, and it took 20 minutes on this hole to get it all the way through. And it was squeaking and snapping, and not snapping like breaking, but making that snapping sound. And I was taking it right up to a serious torque right before I started to twist this thing up. And if it would have broken this off in there, I would have been really disappointed. But now, let's see, left-handedly, I can spin it all the way through, almost. Yeah. Anyway, it goes in easy with this thing, the Allen key. If I can get it in there, there we go. See, it goes in real nice all the way through. Now, I was using two hands on this thing and going about this far each time, and taking it out and cleaning it and re-oiling it and re-anti-seizing it all the way down. So anyway, that was 15-20 minutes on one hole. So we're gonna have to do that all the way around. So this is turning out to be a little bit of a time consumer, a little bit. But I don't look at this disassembly as a mistake. This is, like I said, this is the last chance. If we didn't do it now, this thing was never gonna come apart, and it was just gonna basically rot into one piece, and then eventually when it stopped working, it'd be garbage. In terms of, somebody said I shouldn't be so concerned with airworthiness. In terms of airworthy hardware and airworthiness, airworthy engines, this whole thing is garbage. A helicopter overhaul shop would take a look at this and they would just kick it into the dumpster. But it's not for an aircraft, it's for a boat project, and we're trying to minimize expenses. So we're also trying to, I don't know, make it savable, whatever. It's 50 years old. If it wants to be more than 55 years old when it's finally garbage, it needed to be taken apart now. And we're gonna rehab it, paint the corrodible stuff, rehab the stainless steel inserts. I think they're contaminated with material from the corroded bolts. And these are the most difficult inserts I've ever encountered that weren't completely smashed up. So we're gonna save it. It's gonna take some time. What I've done with the broken bolts is I've used solvent, brake clean, lots of brake clean, to dry out any lube, oil, or whatever, anything else from those holes, blowing them out with air, and now I'm dripping in there that stuff that's the commercial name that I know of it. It's called CLR. This is a generic term of it, a generic version of it, but it removes corrosion, rust, lime deposits, and calcium, lime, and rust is what they name it for, I guess. Anyway, we're gonna leave it in there for a while and see if I can get these out. That's a very important thing. Anyway, it's gonna be a bit of work, so until next time, the next time you see this, we'll probably have this painted and on there, and this will all go back on there. Yes, we did open up a bit of a can of worms, but I believe it was highly necessary to save this thing from becoming unusable garbage. It's pretty close now. Thanks for watching.